What's going on YouTube? Bacon here bringing you another video. This one gonna be my draft recap for Season 5 of OLT Harmony Division. Harmony is essentially the B-League of OLT. Oblivion is the top level, so we're one step below that. But still very, very strong competition. I expect this to be one of the most difficult leagues that I've played in to this point, which is great. Always looking for kind of new challenges and trying to get better here. So, yeah. Really, really glad to have made it into this league. It was an application-based league, and I was accepted, which was great. If any of you have watched Regulator's draft league tier list video, OLT did actually make the cut for that video. Really, really strong league, really good players, and really, really happy to be here. But yeah, without further ado, let's get into the draft itself. This is a points-based draft style, so I've actually not done a points-based league before. This is my first shot at that. We got 120 points to draft between 9 and 11 Pokemon. And obviously there's a multitude of tiers from 18 points all the way down to 1 point for given mons. There's a couple of weird releases, things like Aegislash you don't normally see is free in this league. It's an 18 point mon. Meloetta in just its pirouette form is released at 18 points as well. So it's the normal and fighting type Meloetta that you get after Relic Song, but without having to use Relic Song. So you play custom game, you run Meloetta Pirouette, and you get to use kind of that almost Megalopunny-esque type Pokemon. Really cool idea, actually. I've never seen that done before, but definitely would be a cool mon to use. That was actually the top of my draft board, but obviously it was on the top of a lot of people's draft boards. It actually went second overall. Anyways, I had the 8th overall pick, I believe, which I absolutely hated. Absolutely hated. I'd rather pick such that I have at least close together, have picks that are close together, because if you're picking like one mon every, there are 16 teams in this league, so essentially I was picking one mon every 16 picks, and that was just brutal. Like, it was so hard, because when you have a pick on the wheel or close to the wheel kind of deal, you're able to have an idea of what's going to be able to get paired. You can have a primary option and maybe a secondary option to pair with the Pokemon that you're taking this time around. So, and that's normally not going to be an issue. You'll often get the two primary options that you're looking at when your picks are close enough together. But in this case, I just found I'd have a primary option, I'd have a secondary option, and they'd both be gone by the time it got back around to me. So it's just really frustrating to try and pick from the middle here. If I ever get to pick my draft spot in a different league, I will never, ever, by choice, pick the middle, for sure. I really prefer to pick on the wheel, because then you just kind of know what kind of pairings of Pokemon you're going to be able to put together. But regardless, I still got a pretty interesting draft, not quite as good as I might have liked. But yeah, let's get right into it. So, like I mentioned, 8th overall pick, a couple things were gone by the time my pick came around. Meloetta Pirouette was gone, Aegislash was gone. Those were the first two picks, maybe in reverse order. But those two were gone. I believe Coco was gone. What else was gone? Mega Gallade? No. Lando, I think, was gone. A lot of the common like top threats were gone by the time my pick came around. Celesteela was still around, so that was something I was definitely had my eye on. I've been wanting to use Celesteela in draft for a bit now. But I figured I'd leave that more to like a potential free draft style, like with the MWPA, or with a tier draft style, like the VPL, although obviously this was my last season of the VPL. I don't know, in points, like, Celesteela is one of the 18-point mons, and not that there's a huge difference between drafting an 18-point mon and a 17-point mon, but I just felt like spending a sixth of my points almost on one Pokemon was a little bit much. Unless it was something that I really, really thought was going to be an offensive powerhouse. Celesteela can obviously set up offensively and things like that, but I decided this was not the time for me to draft it. Just kind of the way things that I would like to pair with Celesteela were also priced. It just didn't seem like necessarily the right time for me to do it. So what I did instead was grab Mega Diancie. So Mega Diancie, really huge offensive threat, obviously base 160s on both its attack and special attack stats. Coming in with a Rock and Fairy type, which is a pretty nice offensive typing. Obviously a little bit of a problem with steals, but it does get access to Earth Power to chip those things down. You can run HP Fire for things like Scizor, Ferrothorn, all those kind of mixed 4x weak fire mons. But yeah, Megadeth is just a really strong offensive presence on the team. Gives me magic bounce, so right off the bat, a little bit of hazard control, just in the form of a Mega. Obviously, it's a more offensive Pokemon. Like, even though it's got base 110s on its defenses, it's only got a 50 HP stat, so I'll have to watch out for that. But if I make some good predictions, I can potentially bounce back Stealth Rocks, bounce back Spikes, things like that. And just kind of prevent my opponent from setting up hazards just by way of having Mega Diancie on my team. A lot of Mega Diancies will run Protect, actually, to lead off the game, potentially counter lead a Stealth Rocking option like a Heatran or Swampert, things like that. Kind of bulkier ground types or steel types that would otherwise threaten Diancie. You can just Mega up, get a Protect off, and potentially bounce back Stealth Rocks at them. Which is always pretty cool. You can run sub Endeavor sets, which is kind of neat, actually. I always kind of like the idea of sub Endeavor Mega Diancie to just sub down to 1 HP and remove a potential Steel Tape threat from the opposing side of the field, for example, to allow some of your other Pokemon in the back to do some work later in the game. So, pretty excited to use Mega Diancie here. Definitely a Pokemon I'm not familiar with using at all. Not only have I not used it in Draft League, I've just never used it, period, on OU teams, nothing. Like, I didn't have a Diancie on my cartridge, so back when I played on cartridge most of the time, I missed out on the event, so I didn't actually get a chance to even use it on cartridge. So this will be my first time using it. Hopefully it goes well. I do tend to like Pokemon that have the kind of wall-breaking power that Mega Diancie has. Base 110 speed is good, but not insane, which, I mean, if it was like base 120 or 130 with these offensive stats, it'd be ridiculous, but I'll have to kind of figure out some creative ways to get Mega Diancie in and just start clicking buttons with it throughout the course of the season. Obviously, also one big concern with Mega Diancie is that 4x weakness to steel, particularly makes it vulnerable to things like Bullet Punch coming off Scizors, Pangoros, whatever gets Bullet Punch is going to be a threat to Mega Diancie, of course. So, yeah. That's how we're going to start off the team here. And then kind of the next pick coming in here is an old friend with Scizor, dedicated Sacmon, coming back here. I felt like Scizor plus Mega Diancie was a really nice pairing. I could get some slow U-turns off with Scizor and get in my Mega Diancie on whatever comes in. If it's a fire type, for example, Mega Diancie can pressure that off of a U-turn from my Scizor. Obviously, Scizor only is 4x weak to fire, which is resisted by Mega Diancie, which is nice. And Scizor offers the team a just really nice slate of resistances to start off, most notably being that steel resistance already starting off. Being resistant to that 4x weakness in Mega Diancie. It's really nice for Scizor to help get it in on free switches, get some U-turns off, bait in fire types, and then get my Mega Diancie back onto the field. Kind of the idea behind Mega Scizor here. It's also kind of complementary, and so you got a couple options when you're looking at trying to break through teams. The kind of more obvious one is, okay, I want to have a good Pokemon that can break through my opponent's team, and then it might run into issue with, like, steel types, for example, like Mega Diancie does. So a couple options there are, one, to have a good Pokemon that will deal with steel types, like a really strong offensive fire type or fighting type or something like that. But the other option is just to overwhelm that Pokemon on the opponent's side of the field. So Scizor also has some trouble with steel types. But between Scizor, Mega Diancie, and actually my third round pick as well, my team's going to try to put a lot of offensive pressure onto those steel types, whittle them down over the course of the match, and then open up a door for one of those Pokemon later in the game to potentially late game clean, just because their check to Mega Diancie might also be their check to Scizor, and then also to my third round pick. So just kind of trying to overwhelm my opponent's side of the field. I didn't have like another great idea to pair with Mega Diancie to start off the bat here, so I really liked the utility that Mega Scizor gave the team. It's also giving me my first defogger here, so we're starting off with some decent hazard removal potential on this team, and then Scizor, of course, being kind of the huge threat that it is in UU, also a pretty big threat in Draft League. I used it pretty well in the ABC. My ABC team was ridiculous, but I really liked using Scizor in the ABC. And if I can cover up that fire weakness with the other Pokemon like Diancie, I think Scizor can be really effective on this squad. Next up here, we've got Dragonite, Glader the Dragonite, coming in here. I was kind of torn between whether I wanted to run Salamence or Dragonite on this team, but I've really just wanted the opportunity to use Dragonite. In general, I would say Salamence probably the better Pokemon, but Dragonite definitely has some pretty interesting utility. I was thinking at this point, with Magic Bounce on Diancie, with Defog on Scizor, if I can add a couple more hazard removal options, Dragonite could actually be really interesting on this team, because I can get it in before Rocks. One thing I should mention is I was looking at Rotom Wash here because I figured I could get Dragonite or Salamence in a later round. And I definitely could have, but the plan was to go Diancie, Scizor, Rotom Wash, then take the Dragon type. But unfortunately, Rotom Wash got taken literally the pick before I got to go, and I didn't really have a great backup water at that time that I felt like drafting. Like, I did have other waters in mind, things like Milotic and stuff like that, but I didn't feel like they were worthy of a round 3 pick. So I just kind of stuck to the plan here as best I could and went with Dragonite a little bit earlier than I wanted to. Dragonite pairs pretty nicely with the combo of the Pokemon that I've started with here. Again, getting slow U-turns off with Scizor means that I might not have to bring in Dragonite hard on an attack, which should be able to keep my multi-scale intact. Magic Bounce on Diancie plus Defog on Scizor should help to clear hazards for my Dragonite before it comes onto the field, so I can, again, keep that multi-scale intact. Get some setup in with the Dragonite, just start pounding through his team. Obviously, got another 4x weakness here with Ice-type for Dragonite, but that's decently covered as well by my Scizor. Starting to build up a little bit of a weakness to Rock-type, actually. Not that I only have one Pokemon weak to rocks here, but the other two only take neutral from it, so definitely gonna have to cover up that little bit of a rock's weakness later on. But I felt like Dragonite was just a really nice pairing here. Gives me a ground immunity for my Diancie, should I be so bold as to bring in Dragonite on a free switch, but kind of interesting pairing here with Dragonite. A little bit slow on the base speed stat at base 80, but with its incredible bulk, amplified by multi-scale when it's at full health, it should still be able to get up a Dragon Dance on most things. It's actually got really nice bulk stats across the board with 91, 95, and 100, and obviously a really, really nice base attack stat at 134. It gets priority and extreme speed, really nice coverage options, and even team support options if you want to go that route with Dragonite. It just has a wild move pool, things like Thunder Wave, Tailwind, it gets Roost if you go on a run like a bulkier Dragonite set. Can do a lot of things, actually. It can be specially offensive too. At base 100 special attack stats, not too bad. And against things like Hurricane, Thunderbolt, I believe it gets Flamethrower. So it gets pretty decent coverage on that end as well. Gives me a 4x grass resistance, which pairs nicely with Mega Diancie. So I've got 2 4x grass resistances on the team to pair with Mega Diancie. It's also a water resistance for Mega Diancie, also a fire resistance for Scizor. So just kind of defensive typing wise, even though it's not a defensive Pokemon, it still pairs pretty nicely with my team, and I could potentially use that to my advantage to get set up on other Pokemon. Like I mentioned, this is kind of the third part of a steel pressure type core, if you want to call it that. Mega Diancie, Scizor, and Dragonite can all put a lot of pressure on my opponent's defensive steel type. Things like Skarmory will be kind of pressured to come in on all three of these, and over the course of the match I can knock it off with Scizor, get rid of potential leftovers, hit it with a Z move for my Dragonite, just try to break it so that either Scizor, Dragonite, or Diancie is going to be able to come through in the end game once that defensive steel type is gone. So really, really like Dragonite on the team. Again, could have been a Salamence if I really wanted it to be. Salamence is actually still there to this day. Once the draft has been completed, obviously we get a few free agent transactions throughout the course of the season. If I don't like the way Dragonite is playing out, I may drop it for Salamence at some point. But just starting off here, I felt like Dragonite was not such a bad pairing. So like I mentioned, I did want Rotom Wash on this team. I thought Rotom Wash would have paired really, really nicely. Obviously, I had Rotom Wash plus Scizor in the ABC, and it worked out fantastically. I felt like the 4x steel resistance was going to be really nice for Diancie. It also would have offered a fire resistance for Scizor, an ice resistance for Dragonite. And I was like, well, if I can't have Rotom Wash, I'm going to take Rotom Heat. Gives me kind of the same resistances across the board, though it does make me a little bit weaker to rock. Unfortunately, it's also weak to water, which would have been a nice thing to get out of a Rotom Wash, potentially, would be a resistance to water. That way I could bring in something on Scald, so I wouldn't have to worry about burns. Like, my Dragonite doesn't necessarily want to come in on Scald, even though it does resist water. But defensive typing wise, I felt like Rotom Heat still pretty well fit the bill here. Gives me another defogging option, and it's going to make defogging a little bit more important though as well, because Rotom Heat, of course, is weak to Stealth Rocks itself. But gives me another defogging option at the very least. Helping keep those hazards off for Dragonite is really, really important. But again, starting to compound a little bit of a weakness to rock, so I'm going to have to patch that up going forward. But Burnham Heat, just another really kind of nice pairing here, completing a slow vault turn core with Scizor. Again, the slow U-turn, slow vault switch into things like Diancie and Dragonite is going to be really nice for this team, allowing Diancie to get in on free switches to just click Moonblast, click Diamond Storm, whatever, or to potentially allow Dragonite to get in on something and set up. So, kind of like the utility of Rotom Heat here. I use Rotom Wash pretty well in the ABC, and Rotom Heat, while it's not quite as useful on the team as I was hoping Rotom Wash to be, still should be able to do some good work this season as kind of a defensive pivot type Pokemon. I also could potentially run like Choice Scarf, Choice Specs on the Rotom Forums, as you know. Pretty nice special attack stat at 105, which, if amplified by a Choice Specs, can do some pretty good damage, and a pretty decent speed stat, so if you throw a Scarf on there, it should be able to outspeed most in the metagame if you happen to be running kind of a more offensive build with your Rotom. So, yeah, that's the first four rounds here. Doing okay through the first four rounds. Again, I was really hoping at this point in the draft that I would have my water type locked down. I do want a bulky water on this team to pair with Scizor, pair with Dragonite. I felt like that was going to be really important to have that bulky water type there to cover up their four times weaknesses. And actually, a bulky water type would cover up the four times weakness on Diancie as well. So really kind of important for this team because of those first three picks, but that's something we're going to have to address later in the draft because I believe in round four as well, I was looking at, I can't remember what bulky waters were on the board. Milotic might have still been there. I'm not sure if it was there by the time I drafted. Like, basically, the story of this draft was me getting sniped on the water types that I wanted. I think I got sniped like five times. So, like, that includes picks right before me and picks two before me, if we're counting those as, like, snipes. People were drafting water types like crazy. Like, I believe the guy who had the pick after me, or maybe two after me, drafted something like four water types. And then a couple of people drafted two water types. Somebody might have drafted three water. Basically, the water types were just flying off the board. Some of them got dropped after the draft was complete because we did have a short grace period to make free transactions without having to burn any of our free agent moves. We did have a short break to make transactions there, and some people dropped some of their excess water types, but it just felt like every time I wanted to grab a water type, it just disappeared right before I was able to grab it. And like, that's kind of the difficulty, like I mentioned, with drafting right in the middle, is you have an idea in mind, you have these two Pokemon to pair together, you get one of them, and then 16 picks later, you're not able to get the next, or even your backup option. So, unfortunately, lost out on a lot of water types early in the draft, and that kind of resulted in me pushing back and pushing back and pushing back when I was going to take that water type, just because whichever one I was looking at got taken, and then the like tertiary options that I was looking at didn't feel like they merited drafting in the third round or the fourth round or the fifth round. Like, so I just kept pushing back when I was gonna get my bulky water. So you'll see my water type comes in quite a bit later actually in this draft, but for now we're starting out with an okay core. Really need to fill it out with a water type for sure, and definitely need to start getting some rock resistances in here. So speaking of rock resistances, gonna go with Crocodile here. Nixon the Crocodile coming in here. Crocodile is another Pokemon I have not had the chance to use before, but I felt like it fit in pretty well on the team. It's got pretty decent natural bulk stats, especially for physically defensive type Crocodile sets, because it does get access to Intimidate. You can run like physically defensive Crocodile to deal with offensive rock types. It does have pretty nice defenses, like I mentioned, at 95-80 with Intimidate. Can do pretty well on the physical side. Little bit lacking on the speed tier, but base 92 is certainly not bad. It's a very common choice scarfer in UU to deal with like Latios, Latias. Well, Latias is in UU, but it can be a pretty good choice scarf option to deal with fast psychic types. It can be a good choice scarf option to just even pursue threats to the team. Can force out things like fire types, electric types, get some big pursuit damage off on them and start to chip them down. Gives me another stealth rocking option that's not Mega Diancie, which is of course good. I'll need to add one more, I think, over the course of the match, draft. I usually like to have about three or four stealth rockers on the team, just so my opponent doesn't like get into a groove of, okay, he's got to bring this Pokemon or this Pokemon just to set up stealth rock. So I definitely want to have the option to use multiple Pokemon to set hazards, but Crocodile here coming in round 5 I felt like was pretty nice. Not a particularly expensive choice at, I think, 12 points here for Crocodile, but does give me a little bit of versatility. Offensively, it gets really nice coverage options, things like Iron Tail to hit fairies, and this is a free Z league, so if I do feel like a Z variant of Crocodile would make sense, could run Z Iron Tail, for example, to break through an opposing fairy type that can open the door for my Dragonite, for example, and just kind of help me go from there. spreading knockoff around my opponent's team will also be really nice. I could potentially remove Shookaberries from things that would otherwise be trying to wall my Dragonite or my Diancie. I can hit those things with Earth Power, Earthquake, do a good bit of damage. Things like Heatran, for example, would otherwise be a little bit problematic for my team. Carrying a Shookaberry, Crocodile obviously could threaten that thing out. Just start spamming knockoff at my opponent's team. Remove leftovers from things like Skarmory, like Celesteela. Just start spamming knockoff. Remove items. Set up Stealth Rocks. Taunt things, potentially. It does get access to Taunt to stop things from setting up Stealth Rocks in my face. So I can Taunt into Stealth Rock myself. Things like that. Crocodile is a very nice, versatile Pokemon. And I felt like it fit pretty well on the team here, giving me that Dark and Ground type to start off. Obviously does have a few common weaknesses to things on my team, particularly the ice type weakness that it shares with Dragonite. It shares grass and water with Diancie, but it does have a bug weakness that's pretty well covered by the rest of my team. Everything else on my team actually resists bug to this point, so I wasn't too concerned about that at least. It does give me some pretty useful resistances, things like Dark and Ghost. Ghost itself does not have a lot of resistances in the format. Obviously, it's immune. Normal types are immune to Ghost type moves, but other than that, the only thing that's going to be resisting Ghost is Dark type, so definitely important to have a Ghost resistance on the team, I felt like, and it does give me, as I mentioned, that critical first rock resistance on the team, so yeah, just really like the way Crocodile paired with those first four Mons. Next up here is Cofagricus, Sarcophaghost here, coming in with pure Ghost type, of course, but I felt like the team needed a little bit more bulk on it, so Cofagricus fit the bill pretty well here. It gives me a really nice physically defensive check to offensive fighting types, things like Mega Lopunny, Mega Medicham, Mega Gallade. Like, I can just throw off Will-O-Wisp, burn those things. Really, really nice pairing on the team in terms of setting Toxic Spikes if I want to do that. So, excuse me. Setting up Toxic Spikes against my opponent's team could potentially be really nice. Start wearing them down over the course of the match with Volt Turn plus Toxic Spikes, and then try and get a late game clean with something like Dragonite or Diancie if it happens to outspeed his team at that point. So I always like to have a Pokemon with Toxic Spikes on my team because it can take advantage of opposing matchups where they don't have a ground of poison type. So I do like the potential utility for Toxic Spikes on this team. And Cofagricus could also kind of serve a different role here and run like a Trick Room Nasty Plot type set. It is kind of common, and I believe Cofagricus is RU, maybe NU, but I think it's RU. It can run a pretty reliable, actually, Trick Room Nasty Plot set with Z-Ghost and HP Fighting. Something like that is pretty common to see with Cofagricus, and it can start breaking through your opponent's team when they're not expecting it to. But physically defensive Cofagricus is really nice. It also has a decent special defense stat. Obviously, its HP stat leaves a little bit to be desired, but it can make up for that a little bit by running Pain Split as well. Just a Pokemon I've wanted to use for a while, and I felt like at the price of only 9 points, fit pretty decently on the team. Gives me a fighting immunity for things like my Crocodile, and obviously to this point in the setup here, I only had the one fighting resistance in Dragonite, and in general, like I mentioned, I don't want to be switching in Dragonite to take hits because that'll break my multi-scale, so having just kind of a nice, more defensively oriented Mon that can give me that fighting and normal immunity, give me another poison and bug resist, like, felt pretty decently, felt like it fit pretty decently on the team, and paired really nicely with Crocodile in terms of defensive synergy, so yeah, just liked the pairing with Cofagricus here, and wanted to use this mod for quite some time, so glad I was able to grab it. I think I did snipe somebody on this pick because somebody else was eyeing Cofagricus, but it was kind of at this point in the draft where I had a decent amount of points left, but there wasn't a whole lot that I was super committed to in the upper echelon of Pokemon, and there were a few things that I really wanted to get in the kind of lower tiers, so Cofagricus was the first of those that I kind of maybe reached a little bit for, but I wanted to make sure I kind of secured some of those low point Pokemon that I wanted, and then I'd have some points to burn at the end and just kind of see what was left on the board, because like I mentioned, there wasn't a whole lot that I was looking at that I was super, super interested in grabbing at this point, besides getting some kind of water type, and again, a lot of the water types I was looking at this point in the draft didn't really seem to be meriting like a 6th or 7th round pick, so I was perfectly content to wait on those and potentially get them later in the draft. It seemed like a lot of people already had water types, so I was like, yeah, I should be able to get these water types that I want, and then snipe. But yeah, Cofagricus here, maybe I should grab one of those water types, but at the same time, I was just looking at my team, and like, a water type, while it would be really helpful, there were a lot of things that could fit the bill in some ways, and there was also kind of the other aspect of, I thought I could wait a little bit on the water types just because of how many had already been drafted, and that was kind of a big mistake on my end, which hopefully I will not make again if I if I get into another draft league here going forward. So, yeah. Next up here is Dexter the Empalm. Empalm, I felt like, paired really nicely with this team. My team's already a little slow to this point. You see, my only kind of faster Pokemon is base 110 with Mega Diancie. My speed tiers are certainly not bad by any means, but overall speed on my team is a little bit lacking. And Empalm, I felt like, was a really kind of nice pairing for only 5 points. This is another one of those low-tier type Pokemon that I really wanted to make sure I got before moving forward. Fake Out on Empalm pairs pretty nicely with Cofagrigus because of the potential for Toxic Spikes plus Fake Out to rack up chip on my opponent's team. While its stats are obviously nothing really to write home about, base 100 attack is really not that great. The fact that it does get access to Technician, and of course it has Stab on Fake Out, like Silk Scarf boosted, for example, Technician Stab Fake Out from Empalm is still doing pretty good damage to offensive Pokemon, things like Tapu Koko, Mega Beedrills, Lopunnies, Zeraoras, like all these fast Pokemon that would be pretty problematic for my team. Empalm can help to chip them down a little bit, and then I can use one of my bulkier Pokemon to take a hit and then deal one back and knock out that offensive threat. So Empalm pairs pretty nicely on the team, I think, despite kind of lacking in some offensive stats. You'll see pretty often like a Silk Scarf Technician boosted Fake Out with Return, U-Turn, Knock Off. It does get access to the Elemental Punches, which is nice coverage to round things out. It can run like Ice Punch for Lando, Fire Punch for Scizors, things like that. Pretty nice from the Empalm here. Obviously, not really offering a lot to the team in terms of defensive capabilities. Does have an immunity to Ghost, which, if I'm making some strong predictions, could be nice. But otherwise, obviously more of an offensive type Pokemon. Does have access to U-Turn again, like I mentioned. So it can bait in things like defensive Rock types, defensive Steel types that I can help take advantage of with my Rotom Heat, with my Crocodile. I'll just start kind of keeping people in the U-Turn Bolt Switch Tornado there, and then trying to benefit off that with a late game sweep from Scizor, Dragonite, or a clean from Diancie. So, yeah. Empalm, another Pokemon that I've been wanting to use for quite some time. Just not because it's like particularly godlike or anything like that. It just seems like a pretty kind of interesting niche type Pokemon that I felt like fit pretty well on the team. Next up here is Serenity the Celebi. So I was looking at a couple of grass types. Things like Superior were gone pretty early. Shaymin was gone pretty early, although I was looking at that. And Celebi was something I felt like would last into the later rounds, as it did. And it's definitely got some kind of interesting flaws, but also strengths to it. So obviously it has a ton of weaknesses. You can see across the board there, I believe that's 7 weaknesses, one of them being the 4x weakness to Bug, which kind of sucks because you're weak to U-Turn, which is one of the more common offensive pivoting type moves in the game. But Celebi also offers some kind of interesting potential in other aspects of the game. Obviously, being a Pixie, it's got the base 100s across the board, so you can run it physically if you really want to, but I don't think it really gets very good physical options. So you generally see it run specially offensive, but you can run a more defensive set with like Leech Seed and Recover and things like that. It does have access to Stealth Rock, so it does give me a third potential Stealth Rocking option on the team. You can see I already burned through a Steel type that doesn't get access to Stealth Rocks, and my Ground and Rock types do have Stealth Rocks, but other than that, your really only options are a Psychic type or a Grass type to set Stealth Rock, and so in this case, that's going to be a Psychic type in Celebi. Gives me my third Stealth Rocking option. Does have some decent utility options to it as well. Leech Seed, like I mentioned, could be good to help with my pivoting throughout my team, because my team's not like crazy bulky, but it does have some decent natural bulk on it, so if I can get Leech Seeds up, it could potentially ease switch-ins for things like my Rotom Heat. So Celebi obviously has a lot of weaknesses here that are covered by Rotom Heat. Things like Ice, Bug, Flying, Fire are all covered by Rotom Heat, and then things like Dark and Ghost are covered by Crocodile. It can help me kind of ease my predictions on switch-ins if I get a Leech Seed off, so Celebi could be a threat both defensively and offensively. It fills out a nice speed tier at base 100, which is something I was lacking before this. So we've got kind of a decent demarcation of speed tiers. Again, the team's still a little bit slow, with Empalm being the fastest at base 115. But Celebi is a Pokemon that's been pretty interesting to me for a while. I've always just kind of shied away from it because of that 4x bug weakness, but I want to test it out here, see how it does. It does have a decent slate of resistances, even though it does have a ton of weaknesses in itself. So it does kind of fall prey to some common coverage type options, but at the same time, Celebi, if you kind of, it's going to require a lot of finesse, I think, to use this Pokemon. So hopefully I can manage that finesse over the course of the season and do pretty well with it, but we'll see how it goes. It's just something interesting that I feel like picking up. I feel like the offensive potential of the psychic type on this team is actually pretty well appreciated. Again, this is another thing that gets earth power, so it can pressure opposing steals if I need it to. Leech Seed can also help to wear down those opposing steals in addition, so it'll be a really, really interesting fit on the team. I needed another stealth rocker. It was still sitting around. I needed a kind of grass type on the team. Didn't really care necessarily whether it was a more offensive or a bulkier type of grass type, but I felt like Celebi fit pretty nicely in that niche. Next up here, we finally managed to grab a water type, and this time we got Volcanion. Take all the Volcanion coming in here. Of course, the water absorbability is really nice. I was, like I mentioned, looking for Scald switch-ins, and I found two in Celebi and Volcanion in the later rounds. Celebi, obviously, with the natural cure ability, doesn't care about getting burned or toxic or anything like that. And Volcanion here with the water absorbed, meaning that you cannot scald it in the first place. So, gives me some nice water immunity slash resistance options that aren't Dragonite, so I don't have to worry about getting burned. I felt like Volcanion actually defensively paired really nicely with the team. You can see it's kind of unique typing, giving it 4x resistances to fire, ice, and steel, which are all 4x weaknesses for my first three picks. So from that aspect, it actually fit really nicely defensively. But offensively, this thing is just a monster. Base 130 special attack stat. It's got Super Scald in the form of Steam Eruption, which can, of course, miss. I think it's 95% accurate, though, so hopefully we're hitting those over the course of the season. And Steam Eruption does some pretty nice numbers on opposing teams. Also compare it with Fire Blast, and just really difficult to switch into, because normally you want to bring in your grass type on opposing offensive water types, but obviously Volcanion doesn't care about your grass type with its fire stab, so just kind of really interesting pairing of typings. I believe it's the only, it's the only fire water type in the game, and it's definitely something that, again, I haven't gotten a chance to use very often, because it's another event type Pokemon that I didn't get to use on cartridge, and I never drafted it. But I felt like it could be pretty interesting on this team. I can potentially get it in on, like, HP fire predictions from my Scizor. If I can get in Volcanion and just start firing off really strong Steam Eruptions, Fire Blasts, whatever, it'll be starting to put in a good number on opposing teams. So, really, really liked the option from Volcanion here. And again, like, all of the water types I wanted got sniped. So at this point in the draft, I was just kind of looking around for what was still left, what was going to pair nicely with the team. If Volcanion was still on the board, I was like, you know what, I'll give it a shot. Pretty nice defenses, actually, base 120 and base 90 of Spidef. Defense and Spidef, and then base 80 HP. It's a pretty bulky Pokemon, especially on that physically defensive side, so it can take hits and then fire some back. Actually, can run kind of physically offensive or specially offensive if you want to. Like, specially offensive is generally more effective, but does have access to some decent physical type moves. I believe it gets Stone Edge, obviously Flare Blitz. It might actually not get an offensive water type move, physically offensive water type move. I'd have to check that. It must, right? It must get something like Waterfall, but I'm not certain. You can run like Flame Charge Volcanion, is pretty common to kind of make up for its mediocre speed stat at base 70. You can run like Flame Charge, but still run special, so you get that speed boost, and then you just start firing off strong fire and water type moves. It does also have Sludge Bomb, which gives it a kind of nice middle ground option versus grass types. If they potentially have like a strong, especially defensive fairy type, you can just start spamming Sludge Bomb at them, potentially land a poison, run Z Sludge Bomb. I think it also has access to Solar Beam, maybe? Not certain on that one, but at the very least, you can run like HP Grass to hit things that are 4x weak, things like Seismitoad, Swampert, that might otherwise want to switch in on your Fire Water Stab. You can hit them with an HP Grass and do some good damage to them. So, Volcanion, pretty interesting pick. Again, something I haven't gotten to use before. Actually, a lot of the Pokemon on this team I have not gotten to use before, which is always cool to use some new stuff, and hopefully it works out. Not a super huge fan of what I ended up drafting here in terms of the team as a whole. I think it does have some pretty big weaknesses on the team, but in general, I'm hoping that it can still come through in the end, and I can start to learn how to use some of these Pokemon and start to build more effectively. In general, I start off pretty poorly in my draft leagues and then start to get better over the course of the season as I get more familiar with the team. Hopefully that's going to be the case this season, but we'll see. Just kind of looking at it off the bat, it's I'm a little bit uncomfortable with the team just because I'm so unfamiliar with many of the Pokemon, and like I mentioned, the team is a little bit slow. But yeah, hopefully we can patch that up over the course of the season. Maybe make some free agent transactions going forward if I can figure out a way to kind of keep the main core together. Next up here is Kermit the Toxicroak. Gives me a nice fighting and poison type. Grounded poison type is always really important to have in draft, just in case your opponent has something like a Toxapex and you don't want to get Toxic Spiked. Toxic Robe just gave me a pretty nice option for things like that. Yet another Scald, potential immunity with Dry Skin. Like, I didn't list the immunity to Water, but in general, you're going to be running mostly Dry Skin on Toxic Robe, unless your opponent doesn't have a Water type or something. So, Dry Skin, Toxic Robe, paired pretty nicely with the team, gives me another Scald switch-in. So these last three picks, you can see I was really trying to manufacture Scald switch-ins, so I didn't have to have Dragonite doing that, because that's definitely not something that Dragonite wants to be doing. So, Dry Skin there pairs pretty nicely from Toxicroak. Obviously, he's got that 4x psychic type weakness, but I feel like that's covered pretty decently by the rest of the team. Things like Crocodile can pursue trap opposing psychic types for it. Scizor is pretty good against psychic types in general. Even if they're carrying HP Fire, they're generally not knocking out Scizor, depending on your bulk investment and their offensive investment. But Toxicroak itself, I felt like, offered a pretty nice option to the team in terms of wall breaking potential. Like, SD Toxicroak is a pretty scary Pokemon if your opponent only has kind of like bulkier checks to it. So you gotta switch in something on Toxicroak. And the coverage of Poison plus Fighting is really, really nice. Pressure defensive fairy types on the other side of the field while also pressuring defensive steel types. So really, really nice offensive stabs from Toxicroak, and it also gets access to things like Bullet Punch and Sucker Punch for priority. And then on the specially offensive side, it does have access to Nasty Plot, so even though it's only got base 86 special attack, which is not great, it does still have options there. It gets, of course, Sludge Bomb, Vacuum Wave for priority on that side, and you can really, like, see Sludge Bomb Toxicroak. I believe it also gets things like Dark Pulse to hit psychic types, things like that. So really interesting Pokemon that I've actually been wanting to use again for a long time here, but I never really found a team where I felt like it fit, and it doesn't necessarily fit on this one, but in terms of like looking at typings that I need to fill out and maybe team roles that I need to fill out here at the back end of my draft, I thought Toxicroak actually fit pretty decently on this squad, to be honest. So I'm kind of excited to use it. Gives me another rock resistance, even though Toxicroak itself is certainly not any kind of bulky Pokemon, but at least gives me another rock resistance nominally on that side. Last up here, we've got Snooki the Jinx. So this was actually Sigilyph at the end of my draft, but I was like, what? Basically, when round 11 came through, I had 7 points left, and I was like, I don't know what I want to pair on this team. Like, I've never really had an issue with just saying, oh, this is definitely going to be the next Pokemon I want. This is definitely going to be the next Pokemon I want, and then finishing off my draft that way. But in this case, I was just like, I don't know what I want with this last pick. So rather than picking nothing, I picked Sigilyph, and then in that grace period following the end of the draft, I converted Sigilyph to Jinx. Obviously, that leaves me with 3 points left over, so if I want to make some free agent transactions or trades later in the season, I can't do that because I do have some extra points left over. But Jinx, I felt like, actually paired pretty decently on the team. I don't have an ice type on the team yet, so this does give me that. Another Dry Skin user, so another potential Scald switch in on the team. You see, I'm very scared of Scald with this team, as I kind of should be, given that my first three picks are all, or first five picks actually, are all not super happy about Scald. So, yeah, Jinx, I felt like, paired pretty decently. Obviously, he's got absolutely nothing on the physically defensive side. Base 35 defense and base 65 HP is, it's gonna die to a Light Breeze on the physical side, but it's actually got some decent special bulk at base 95, and a really nice special attack set. Stat and speed tier. You can run like Choice Scarf Jinx, you can run the Nasty Plot Z Lovely Kiss Jinx that you mostly see in the lower tiers of Smogon. Yeah, it's just kind of an interesting Pokemon. Never really something I'd considered drafting before we got into the draft, but then by the time the end rolled around, I was like, you know what? Jinx actually fits fairly decently on the team. I'll give it a shot, see what it can do. I don't know how many games I'll end up bringing it to, if any. But it does offer a kind of decent offensive option on the back end here. Able to pressure defensive ground types, things like Landorus can definitely pressure that. It does outspeed Landorus Therian form, which is nice. Lando Eye is also in this league, which it doesn't naturally outspeed, but I could run like Choice Scarf Jinx potentially, or of course the Z Lovely Kiss set. It does get a boost to its speed. It's kind of interesting Pokemon here. Something I've never used ever again, like on cart or on Smogon or draft or anything like that. I've never used Jinx, so we'll see if it does anything. Like I mentioned, I didn't know what I wanted to do with this 11th round pick, so I was like, you know what, screw it, we'll run Jinx here and see how it does. So yeah, that rounds out the squad here. Again, not super thrilled with how the team ended up turning out. Kind of the picture I had in my head. Just really got screwed over for some reason by not being able to get Rotom Wash and having to take Rotom Heat instead. Like, it's just a very different mindset having a good defogger that's not weak to rocks versus having a good defogger that is weak to rocks really actually makes a huge difference in general. But yeah, it's okay. I think the team's not bad for sure, but it's definitely not the best that I've drafted, so hopefully can still do well this season. Gonna be a really tough season, like I mentioned. I think this is probably the most competitive league that I've been a part of to this point, in terms of just the players, so hopefully we can do pretty well here. It's an 8-week season. Week 1 should be going up fairly soon. I have already played that match, so you guys will see the result of that one coming up pretty soon here, and I hope you guys stick around for the rest of the OLT Harmony Season 5 here. So thank you very much for watching if you did to this point. Hope to see you guys in another video, and I will see you guys next time. Later.